Greetings, everybody. For those that decided to come to the talk tonight, you can go ahead and leave your phones on for me. And turn Bluetooth on, please. No, just kidding. It's fantastic to be here. Ghost in the Wires took 2 years. Myself and my co-author, Bill Simon, raise your hand, worked on this. Great. I couldn't have done it without Bill. I mean, we had different work schedules because I usually slept into 2 p.m. and worked to 5 a.m. And Bill, you know, woke up at 6 a.m. and worked to what, 6 p.m. So, I mean, I put him on Spanish time for about 2 years, right, Bill? So you're ready for the second edition. So, as you might know, if you know a little bit about my background, I obviously was a computer hacker that ended up in a lot of hot water. And for 7 years, I was actually restricted from actually writing this book. I was released from custody in 2000. In 2007, after 7 years, and I was permitted to go ahead and tell the story. And how I started with computer hacking was really from my love of magic. As a young kid, 10 years old, I used to ride my bike to the magic store just to learn how the tricks worked because I was so fascinated with it. And then when I entered high school, and I know you're going to probably read a lot of this in the book, is I met this kid who can do magic with the telephone system. And he was what you call the phone freak. Anyone here read 2600 magazine? Okay, a few. He was a phone freak, and he can do like, he was able to do really incredible stuff. For example, if I call forwarded my number somewhere, he was able to break through it. If my parents had an unlisted number, he can get it in 15 seconds. And one day he said, hey, Kevin, I'm going to give you a cool trick. You call this telephone number, you wait for a tone, you put in 5 digits, and you can call anywhere in the world for free. And I go, how does that work? And he went, well, it must be a fluke with the phone company. Later on, I learned it was like probably some poor company's MCI code. But he showed me all this, you know, all this cool things he could do. And I just was taken aback with this technology. It was just like, wow. And he kind of showed me how he can get information from the phone company. If he had my parents' number, he can get the name it was listed to. If he had a friend's name, he can get the non-published number. It was like this kid had full control over the phone company. So I became a phone freak. But I love pranks. And what I used to do with my phone knowledge, actually pull pranks on friends. One of my favorite pranks was to modify my friend's phone service and the phone company switch. So whenever he or his parents would make an outgoing call on their home phone, it would say, please deposit a coin. Please deposit. And I just loved doing this type of stuff. I remember as a kid, I was able to intercept directory assistance. So anybody calling directory assistance in Providence, Rhode Island, rather than getting the directory assistance operator, they got me. And you could imagine when you're 16 years old how much fun you could have with that. And of course, I do things like what city, you know, Providence, may have the name, please. Whatever, Bill Smith, and I'd say, well, that number is 554-21537, and the confused woman would go, what? And I go, 554-21537. She goes, well, how do I dial a half? Oh, you didn't get our new phones. You have to go down to the phone store. So I was fascinated, you know, by this stuff, and then I got into ham radio. And ham radio opened up a whole new world for me. It was like Advanced Citizens Band, but again, with my prankster-typer persona, I did my favorite hack of all times. And my favorite hack was actually to McDonald's. And what this hack was, does this actually work when I walk around? What this hack was is, imagine a customer drives up to the McDonald's drive-up window, and I'm sitting across the street. I could actually overpower the guy with the headset in the McDonald's, and I could be now the McDonald's customer service person. So you can imagine what fun you had. You know, people would come up, I'd like a Big Mac, large fry, Coke. Oh, we don't serve hamburgers anymore. You know, we now serve tacos. Police would drive up, and then I'd act like a whispering, oh, get rid of the cocaine, get rid of the cocaine. You know, oh, yeah, yes, sir, may I take your order? I could see the poor guy inside the McDonald's freaking out, right, because he could hear everything that was going on, but couldn't stop it. And one of the, you know, again, you know, we're 16, 17 years old, and one of the pranks that's actually in the book is a customer drive forward, may I take your order, please? Oh, our Coke machine's broken, but we're offering free apple juice. Would you like a free apple juice? And they go, yes. And I say, well, our ice machine's broken, but go ahead and drive four. Oh, would you like small, medium, or large? And they go, well, of course, large, it's free. Then we play a recording of what sounded like peeing in a cup. You know, please drive forward. And then after irritating McDonald's so much, the manager comes out of the store and he's peering into every car in the parking lot trying to find the culprit. Right? We're across the street, across the, you know, major street. And then he walks over to the speaker on the drive, you know, on the drive-up window, and he puts his face this close, and I couldn't resist, right? I keyed on my mic, I go, what the fuck are you looking at? And this guy flies back like 10, 15 feet, stumbling, you know, like the McDonald's drive-up windows possessed. So anyway, then I said, you know, I pushed the envelope. You know, I after I got involved with, you know, hacking, and mainly my hacking was to gain more control over the phone company's systems so I could pull more pranks. And then I got involved with, you know, hacking into all the phone company switches throughout the United States. And I started, like, really pushing the envelope because as I was doing this, I was having problems with the phone company security department to the point where when I was 17 years old, they sent a letter to my mom, we're removing your phone service. And my mom was so angry with me that she grounded me. But, you know, but I said, Mom, don't worry about it. I can get our phone back. So we lived in a condominium complex, and our unit number was 13. And I called a certain department in the phone company that does provisioning for new lines and stuff, and I told them that there's a new unit being added to this property. This unit's going to be added, and it's unit 12B to go ahead and provision it. And then a few days later, I went to the hardware store, you know, fished out a 1, a 2, and a B, took down 13, put up 12B for our unit number, called the phone company and ordered service for unit 12B. Now, when I did this, I guess I had a little bit of chutzpah because I asked for a special number, and I asked the telephone company, I'd like a number ending in 007 because my favorite shows at the time were James Bond. And she goes, no problem, sir. And then she goes, what's your name? I go, Jim Bond. And I'd like a number ending in 007. And she didn't even flinch. And then at the end of the conversation, I said, well, you should maybe make the listing out of my phone service to my real first name, which is James. So I had a number of James Bond, 895-5007. So we had that number for about 3 weeks before the phone company got wise. And, you know, one day the phone just went dead. So about 6 months later, they finally gave us phone service back. So at one point in my life, I was arrested for hacking into Digital Equipment Corporation. And the government at the time really needed this, like, set an example for, hey, we have this behavior, this hacking, it's scaring us. We need to set an example for everyone, you know, in the United States. So I remember when I was going for a detention hearing, that's a bail hearing in a case, the federal prosecutor had told a judge that if not only do we have to detain Mr. Mitnick, but we have to make sure he doesn't get near a telephone in prison. And the prosecutor said, the reason is Mr. Mitnick could pick up a phone, dial into NORAD, and whistle the launch codes. And I'm in court. I actually laughed because I thought that was incredibly stupid of the guy because I figured he was going to lose all credibility. And once you know it, the judge bought it hook, line, and sinker. So I was in solitary confinement for about a year. But would you think putting someone like me in solitary confinement was going to stop me? No. So they had a special list of phone numbers that I can call. It was my wife at the time. The marriage didn't really work out because I was in custody. But that's another story, as you can imagine. I was allowed to call my attorney, my mom, my father, my aunt. And what they would do is I was in the hole. I was in high security. So before when you are moved from outside your cell, they actually handcuff you. And they shackle your legs. And then they move you to a phone room, which has three pay phones on the wall. And then a guard with me would look in a book and say, okay, Mitnick, who do you want to call today? I'd say, I want to call Mom. He would dial the phone number, 0 plus the number, because I could only make collect calls, and hand me the phone, and back up through 3 to 4 feet and sit in a chair, and he wouldn't take his eyes off me. Right? So I was thinking, how can I defeat this? Well, as I was, the handset was cord was quite long, so I'd walk back and forth, and I'd be always like scratching my back. I'd be rubbing my back against the phone, and I just got the guard used to this behavior. And then I would actually put my hand behind my back as I'm leaning behind the phone, and I could feel the switch hook. And then I thought one day, I was in a conversation, and I just ended the call, but I kept talking as if the call didn't end. And what I did is I leaned back, I hold down the switch hook, and then I put my arm in front, because you have 18 seconds before the phone's going to go beep, 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 beep. So I knew this, you know, with my phone freaking experience. So within about 5 seconds later, I go to scratch my back again. I dial 0 plus another phone number. And then the next thing that is going to happen is an operator is going to come on and say, who's the call from? So I just said, yeah, well, Mom, you know, tell Uncle Harry Kevin says hello. And when I said Kevin, that's when the operator goes, who's the collect call from? And then I was able to call anywhere to anybody that would accept the collect call while in high security on a court-ordered, you know, phone restriction. So that lasted only about a few weeks. Then one day, my cell door opens. It's the executives of the prison. They shackle me up. They put me in this attorney-client conference room, and they sit me down, and the captain goes, how you doing it, Mitnick? I go, how am I doing what? He goes, you're redialing the phone. Our officer is watching you, and somehow you're redialing the phone. I said, hey, guys, I'm not David Copperfield. I don't know what's going on with your monitoring system, but I don't know what you're talking about. Because, of course, you know, I'm in custody. Why would I admit anything? So 2 days later, I hear some commotion outside the door of my cell, and it's Pacific Telephone installing a jack. And I go, maybe these guys are just going to install a phone in my room so they don't have to bother with me anymore. But I learned what happened the next day is when I had to make a phone call, a guard brings the phone, plugs it into the jack, and they had a 25-foot handset cord. So what they did is they placed the handset, you know, through the trap door of the cell, and then Kevin couldn't touch the touchtone pad. So it kind of reminded me of Silence of the Lambs and Hannibal Lecter. Right? So I'll tell you one of my favorite hacks of all time, not because I'm proud of it, but because it illustrates a technique I have throughout the book called social engineering. And what social engineering is where you use manipulation, deception, and influence to get someone to do something they wouldn't ordinarily do. Hackers will, you know, ask for passwords, maybe 5% of the time, or usually get someone to do something that lets the attacker in. Like today, how it works is they have a thing called spear phishing, where an attacker will do some research, find somebody that works within a company they want to compromise, try to find out who that person deals with, vendors, suppliers, customers, other facilities of the same company, and then what they'll do is they'll manufacture an email and send a booby-trapped PDF file. And the PDF file is booby-trapped, so when they open it up, it exploits a vulnerability in Adobe Acrobat. And now the hacker is now on that person's desktop, which is connected to their internal network. That's kind of an example of using social engineering to get somebody to do something that gives the attacker some sort of benefit. So let's go back to 1993. I'm living in Denver, Colorado. And at the time, I wasn't living under Kevin Mitnick because there were certain federal law enforcement agencies that wanted to talk to me, and I didn't want to talk to them. In fact, I was using the name Eric Weiss. Does anyone know who Eric Weiss is? Harry Houdini. I thought I had a sense of humor, but much later I found that the FBI has no sense of humor. But that's a story for another day. So my colleague at the law firm, one of the guys that worked in the IT department, handed me this brochure for the MicroTac ultralight cell phone. And this cell phone is kind of like the iPhone of today. It was like, you know, if you're a Trekkie fan, it reminds you of the Star Trek communicator, right? And as a hacker, I wanted to understand how this worked because I was the type of hacker who my number one driver was pursuit of knowledge. I wanted to know how things worked. I had curiosity, and I liked, you know, doing things I wasn't supposed to do for the fun of it. It wasn't about destroying stuff or stealing money. But I wanted to get access to this firmware. And Motorola, you can't call Motorola and say, hey, I'd like your firmware, please, because the source code that makes up the firmware is proprietary. It's kind of like, remember the old Orange Julius with the secret powder? Same kind of concept. So while I was in Denver working at this law firm, I left the office about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I called up directory assistance for 1-800 numbers and got the number from Motorola. And I asked the operator, obviously for the number, was given an 800 number. I called the number, and I said, listen, I'm looking for the project manager of the MicroTac Ultralight project. And this was just the 800 number to Motorola. And the nice receptionist told me that all the cellular development is handled out of Schaumburg, Illinois, and asked me if I would like the number. Of course, I call that number. I give the same story. I'm looking for the project manager of the MicroTac Ultralight project. And I'm transferred around 2, 3, 5, 8 times, and now I'm talking to the vice president of research and development for all of Motorola, all of their mobility devices. And I say, hey, this is Rick over in Arlington Heights, because during my previous phone calls, I found out they had an R&D facility in Arlington Heights. And I said, I'm looking for the project manager of the MicroTac. And he goes, well, that's Pam. She works for me. And I said, hey, can I get her extension? He goes, sure, her extension is such and such. And then he said, could I help you with anything? And I go, oh, no, I'll just deal with Pam, but thank you very much, and the call ends. So then I call Pam, and instead of getting Pam, I get her outgoing greeting on her voicemail. And she told her callers that she just left on a 2-week vacation, and if you need any help whatsoever, to please call Alicia on extension, blah, blah, blah. And, and pretty much that was the voicemail, and the date she was returning from vacation, and so on and so forth. So who's my next call to? No brainer, Alicia. I call Alicia. Hey, Alicia, this is Rick over with Hi, Alicia, this is Rick over with R&D in Arlington Heights. Did Pam leave on vacation yet? Oh, she did, because before she left, she was supposed to send me the source code to the MicroTac Ultralight. I'm walking down, Broadway in downtown Denver. It was snowing. Horns were honking, and I was trying to press the cell phone I was using really tight to my ear so she couldn't hear the traffic, because I was never expecting this to work. This is all extemporaneous. So she goes, Rick, she goes, what version do you want? And I'm thinking, I don't even know their version numbers, right? I didn't even check. And I go, how about the latest and the greatest? And she's typing on her computer, and I could hear the key clicks going. And she goes, Rick, I found the latest release of Doc 2, that's what they called it, and there's a problem. What's the problem? She goes, there are hundreds of directories, and within each directory there are hundreds of files. And I asked her, I go, do you know how to use tar and gzip? That's like WinZip under Windows, where you could take a whole bunch of files and make them into one. And she goes, no. And I go, would you like to learn? I could teach you. And she goes, yes, I'd love to learn new things. So I became her instructor for the day. And at the end of that day's lesson, we had a 3-megabyte file that contained the source code to the phone that I wanted to study so I could understand how it worked. My next question was, do you know how to use FTP? And she goes, file transfer program? I go, precisely. And then as I'm walking down, I go, oh my God, I didn't prepare for this. She's actually going to send me the code. And I couldn't give her my host name of hacker@colorado.edu. Right? Because that's obviously outside of Motorola's domain, but I had a great knack for remembering IP addresses. So I remembered an IP address to a system where I had anonymous accounts on, and I gave her the IP address, and when she tried connecting to it, it would time out. She tried it 2, 3, 4 times. And then she goes, Rick? I go, yeah, because I'm disappointed, because I'm thinking, how am I going to get the file? She goes, I'm going to have to talk to my security manager about what you're asking me to do, because I think this is a security issue. And I go, no. Wait. And I'm on hold. Then I'm going, oh my God, the gig is up. So, when you're waiting for somebody to return to the phone and seconds feel like minutes. So I'm walking down the street on the way home. I'm almost to my apartment. And it's like 5 minutes already. I assume that Motorola is already hooking up the tape recorder, right? Because that's going to be Exhibit A for a court case later. So she comes back on the line, and then I'm careful. I don't actually talk. She goes, Rick? Uh-huh. She goes, I talked to my security manager about what you're asking me to do. I go, huh. That IP address you gave us is outside of Motorola's campus. Uh-huh. Notice I'm not talking. I'm just saying, uh-huh. Then she said, well, my security manager told me that that we have to use a special proxy server to send files outside of Motorola. I go, uh-huh. She goes, I don't have an account on that proxy server. And I guess I'm sorry for moving back and forth here. I don't have an account on the proxy server, but my security manager was kind enough to give me his personal username and password so I could send you the file. So by the time I put the key into the front door of my apartment in Denver, Colorado, I had the source code to the micro attack. Now, you think about Motorola, they're a great company. They have the best security that money can buy, firewalls, intrusion detection systems. The problem was is they didn't train their people well enough to fall for a gag like this, and I ended up getting prosecuted for it, but it was so damn easy to do, right? So easy. So eventually I became a fugitive, and a lot of the book covers my cat and mouse with the FBI. The FBI had sent an informant to help them nab me, and then I was able to figure out that this guy was truly an informant that was working against me. And then I was so curious about what was going on, I just had to know, is I hacked into the local cell phone provider, kind of like AT&T or T-Mobile, but this was actually Pactel Cellular, and I was able to identify the telephones of the FBI agents that were chasing me. And I was actually able to do traffic analysis on the phone, so I could see who's calling them, who are they calling, who are those people calling. And I was also able to get location information, so I was basically watching the feds trying to capture me and playing this cat and mouse game. Eventually, I was able to set up a device at my office, and I was working as a PI in Los Angeles. I was able to set up a device so if any of the FBI phones came within 1 or 2 miles of me, it would send me an alert. Kind of my FBI early warning system. So one day on September 28th, 1992, I'm walking into the office early, which is kind of unlike me, and I put in the code to get into the office, and I keep hearing this beep, 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 beep. I'm going, what did they do, change the code? And as I'm walking to my office, the beeping is getting louder, and I hear that it's actually coming from my office, and then I start getting concerned that somebody put some type of tracking device in my office. I go up to my computer, and it's actually detected an FBI cell phone within the area like 2 hours ago. So after like looking into this, I figured out that the FBI did not come to arrest me. They actually came to search my apartment. So what I did is I wanted to help them out, so I went over to Winchell's Donuts, and I bought a big box. Well, after cleaning my apartment out, making sure there was nothing interesting there, I went and got a big box of donuts and wrote FBI donuts on the box, stuck them in the refrigerator, and a couple days later they came to search, and they were kind of irritated when they found the box. But again, I was in this like insane cat and mouse game with the federal government. Eventually, as always, the FBI always gets their man. I was arrested. In 1995, they threw the book at me. I was in solitary again for a while. I went through a long process of dealing with the federal government, and we finally settled the case. And three months after I got out of custody, who's calling? Senator Fred Thompson and Joseph Lieberman. They want me to come to Washington so I could advise them on how to protect any computer systems that are owned or operated by the federal government. And I thought that was quite an honor. I was actually flattered. Here I'm walking out of custody after being this, you know, bad hacker, and now the government is now asking me for my help. So I went and I testified and I offered them all the advice I could. And then I basically, from that point, became what we call an ethical hacker. Is now I hack into systems all the time. In fact, a couple days ago, I broke into a server. The only difference is now I have authorization that the company now allows me to hack in so I could find their security holes so they could fix them before the real bad guys break in and cause some damage. So there's a little bit about my story. I have some cool demos to show you, because when I do speaking engagements around the world, nothing makes the audience happier than doing some hacking demos. So you interested in taking a look?
Yeah.
All right, great. Perfect. About 6 months ago, I had an assignment to break physically into my client's building in San Diego, California. And have you ever seen a lot of access devices that are physical use these HID cards, right? These are HID cards. What this device is, and I didn't build it, I simply bought it, but it's available. It's called a Proxmart 3. This is an HID card spoofer. So if I can get close enough to somebody that's wearing the card, I could steal the access credentials and then replay them into the device. Now imagine if you're wearing a suit, this is the back, you put this in the pocket, you put this device, and you run this up the sleeve and you tape it. So you can actually just, hey, hi, how you doing? Tap somebody on the shoulder, and it will be close enough to capture the credentials. So I'll show you how this works. It's kind of cool. Let me see. I have three demos to show you that I think are kind of neat. So if you take, this is like a HID reader, right? So let's kind of pay attention to the screen. If you pass the card, hold on a second. Let me restart this. Of course, Murphy's Law, right? Where's my mouse? I think my machine froze. One second. I don't even see the mouse. Is it up there? Jesus Christ. Oh, there it is. All right. Who's hacking into my machine? All right. Let's see. Okay, so this is like a card ID is 64038 and the site ID is 113. You've probably seen this on a lot of doors, probably around New York City. So imagine I'm the bad guy. I'm going to lay it this way. And I want to steal the credentials of this card. So all I have to do is, set this up. I have this little battery pack. Because you're obviously not going to carry a computer with you to do it. So the battery pack is hidden, kind of like a magician. This is the antenna where you want to steal the credentials. So basically how it works is if you press down this button, it basically goes into a mode where this is one LED is lit. So this is replay mode. So if you pass it in front of the device, there shouldn't be anything there. Can you hold that up for me? I forgot my, just nothing is there because there's nothing to replay. And then what I do is I press down here and you'll see another LED and now it's in listen mode. So now it's waiting for you to steal the card credentials. So I'll just pass it through and take a look at that light. As I touch the card, you'll see the light goes off. So it's now stolen the credentials. So now I stole them. Now I want to go use them. All I have to do is press the button again. And now it's in play mode. So as I pass, can you lift that up for me, sir? As I pass the card, now it's stole the credentials. Right? So this is called an HID card spoofer. And so if somebody's getting too close to you and patting you on the back and you have it on your lanyard around the neck, they might just be not really a good friend of yours. They might be trying to steal your credentials. So I actually use this in security assessments when companies hire me to break in. I actually find restaurants, Starbucks, where the employees are, and usually a lot of them are wearing it on their hip rather than around their neck. It takes a second, just brush by them, steal their card credentials, and now I'm them. So that's one attack. Kind of cool, huh? All right, so let me show you another cool one. This is called my spy bridge. Everybody's heard of phishing, right? You ever get an email from Citibank, from eBay, from PayPal, telling you there's been a problem with your account? Please click this hyperlink, and it brings you to a page that definitely isn't PayPal or eBay or whatever. It's a scammer trying to steal the credentials. But now, as the industry has push down in that bubble of fraud on phishing, what it does is it just pops up somewhere else. So now phishers are using voice response systems to scam people. So you ever call your bank and you hear, you never get a person anymore. What happens is you get an automated system and they want you to put in your credentials, your account number, your password. And then if it's correct, then they eventually transfer you to somebody. So imagine if I could send you an email make it look like it's coming from your financial institution, but instead of asking you to click on a link because you're told not to do that, because everybody in this room is smarter than that, and you're not going to fill out a form, but it says, we found a problem with your account. Please call us within the next 24 hours, or your account will be terminated. What are the chances you'd just simply call the bank? Let me show you what happens. What happens if I send you the email and you go ahead and call your bank. So I want you to watch the screen. I'm going to try to put this on speakerphone. Does this actually work? All right. So everybody could hear it because I don't have a phone here. And what we're going to do is we're going to call Chase. All right, let me get a... Does anybody have a Chase card here? I don't know why nobody volunteers. I have one. So imagine you get an email, and it says to call Chase. So I'm going to... What's the number on the back? Whoops. I'm going to put this on speakerphone so you'll hear it. And then I want you to watch my computer as this happens. And this is the real bank. Do you hear that? It's asking me for my credit card account number. Wait. That's weird. Oh, there we went.
We're sorry. The number you entered was not recognized. Please enter your full 16-digit credit card account number.
Some people will put in their account number, put your pens away. So it's capturing the card number in real time. Sorry, the...
Please enter your zip code.
So that's having me authenticate with my zip code. 89074.
To speak to an advisor, please press 0 at any time. Your current balance is 11,000.
Okay. So...
balance.
That's a big balance. So, anyway... it's all these expensive hotels here in New York. So, anyway, how this actually worked is I did a man-in-the-middle attack. I give out a telephone number that looks like it's the bank's number. It's like a toll-free number. When the victim calls it, they're calling a number that I have control of. It connects to a system running open source asterisk, and then my system calls out to the real bank. So I'm the man in the middle. So you could do all the transactions, talk to the customer service rep, and I get all your credentials. And there's no way to detect this. The only way to detect it is to be wary if somebody sends you an email to actually check to make sure that that phone number actually belongs to the bank. So this is kind of... The way hackers were doing this before, and I thought of this as a better system, is they'd set up open source asterisk, which is open source PBX, is what they would do is they'd call banks, credit card companies, and they'd record all the prompts. And then they'd set up their own number so it sounds like the bank and feels like the bank. But if you put in your real credentials, it just doesn't work because it's a fake. And what they do is they'll basically say, well, we're sorry, there's been a problem with your account, and then please talk to our customer service rep, and we'll transfer you to music on hold forever. Right? So this is a better way. And one last demo that I thought would be cool to show. It's about getting information on people. So I need a volunteer. What I'm going to try to do is I'm going to try to get your address, your phone number, your date of birth, and social security number within about 60 seconds. So if I could do it, then you know that the identity thieves could do it too. And this is kind of a wake-up call to show you how easily somebody can get your information on the internet. So I'm looking for somebody that doesn't have a name like Bill Smith, somebody, you know, that has established credit, not somebody that's like right in high school. So do I have any volunteers? Yeah. And you have to allow me to display all your stuff to everybody in this room. Come on down. Come on down. And you have to give me your real name. Don't give me somebody else's name. Like, I know you're not Donald Trump. All right. So I'll show you. So these are the databases. You live in New York?
Sorry?
You live here in New York?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So here's a database that anybody could subscribe to. Hold on, let me make the window a little bit different here. And what we're going to do is, I'll just do a name and state, make it easier. So what's your name?
Ryder.
Spell it.
R-E-I.
that's good. That's not going to be like a Bill Smith or a Terry Jones, is it? So let's see what we could find in New York. How long have you been in New York?
Oh, my life, 22 years.
Okay, we should find you. All right.
Uh-oh.
So for like $1.50, let me show you what identity thieves can do. It's kind of scary. So is that you?
My lawyer can answer that question.
You're young, you're 22. So, I mean, this is how easy identity thieves could use databases to basically get your social, your date of birth, to get driver's license information. That's easy as well. What?
What about you personally do nothing online? I personally communicate almost everything by U.S. mail or by telephone.
Doesn't matter. In fact, people think their mother's maiden names are secret. So I'll show you another cool... In fact, what's your mother's maiden name? What? Oh, thank you very much. I'll use that later. Okay. I'm sorry. All right. So hold on a second. Hopefully my account still works here. And this is kind of scary. This actually, I was surprised. Now, in case you're looking for my password, it's Kevin123 to make it easier. Oh. All right. So, mother's maiden names. Like, who played in Catch Me If You Can? Who played Frank Abagnale?
DiCaprio.
Let me see if we could find... He was born in California, I think. So let's see if we could find his mother's maiden name if I was an identity thief. So DiCaprio, I think it's spelled that way, or D-I, right? And then we'll just look for anyone with, Leonardo. We'll do a search. There we go. So we found Leonardo DiCaprio. His mother's maiden name is Indeber. So that's how easy it is. You live in a database nation. So basically, crooks can get your mother's maiden name, your driver's license number, your social security number, your date of birth, your addresses, and your phone number. So never use those as a password. I remember calling my bank 5 years ago, and they go, how they had authenticate me is the last four of my social. I said, I kind of want to use a password, please. And they said, no, you your social is secure. Nobody can get it. I go, can I get your name? I want to show you something cool. Oh, no, sir, I can't do that. So I wasn't able to show the bank employee that the social is kind of like an open book. So I'm here to sign books, or we can open it up for Q&A. I have a gift for all of you that have showed up tonight. And the gift is my business card. So what's cool about this business card? What's cool is if you get locked out of your house, this is a lockpick set. So every time I go through the airport and TSA, because I'm carrying a lot of them, I get a bag check, and then they look at it, they go, that's kind of cool, that's a circuit board. I go, no, it's not a circuit board. And then I explain to them it's a lockpick set, they go, cool, can I have one? So I make friends with everyone at TSA as I travel. So after my talk, I have a card for all of you as kind of a gift. So you can ask me anything you want, except my passwords. And I'll be happy to, and then we'll do some book signings or whatever. So,
if everybody could please wait for the mic, it's just important for the recording so everybody can hear. Just a second, please.
Hi, the name's Ellie. Now that you've revealed,
I know your name.
Shoot me now. Now that you've revealed everything, how do I conceal and keep everything private for the future?
As Scott McNeely says, you have no privacy, get over it. I mean, that's the problem. That's why there's such a problem with identity theft in America, that it's just so easy to steal the information. Right? It's just simple. And that's the problem. The system is broken because you authenticate on your social security number or mother's maiden name, which is, not the thing to do nowadays.
Do you agree with your friend Adrian Lamo with your friend Adrian Lamo? Your friend Adrian Lamo or Lamo?
Oh, Adrian Lamo, yeah.
Do you agree with his decision to go to the authorities?
I don't agree with why he went to the authorities. Adrian Lamo is the guy that turned in Bradley Manning, who was the I think the private in the U.S. Army who stole the documents from CIPRNet and turned them over to WikiLeaks. And what I know Adrian's background, and I know the only reason he did it was for the media attention. He didn't do it because he was a patriot or that he was afraid to be a co-conspirator. So I think he did it for the wrong reasons, to basically inform on somebody for his own personal benefit. So for that reason that he did it, I don't agree with it. If, on the other hand, he did it because he wanted to protect the country, or if he did it because he was afraid of being prosecuted as a co-conspirator, then 100% he should have done it. So there's my answer.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Any other? You want to wait for the mic?
Hi, Reva Richmond. I wondered if when people use a service like reputation.com or something to get themselves removed out of a lot of these databases, whether that actually works.
No, you get removed out of some, but, I mean, the information's already out there and it's bought and sold, so there's no way to get your... The only way to get yourself out of databases is to do what I did, create new identities, but I wouldn't suggest it. That's the only way, unfortunately. Yeah. Yes, sir. Do you have a mic? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Steve. First, I wanted to thank you for the radio interview this morning. That's how I learned about this.
Ah, great, on KGO.
Now, I've been involved in education, and I teach a lot of stuff with computers and robotics. Now, a number of years ago, I personally got into this thing with a company that was developing software, basically, that was encrypting your own personal email, your own personal messages.
Okay.
One of the companies was using an algorithm called Blowfish.
Yeah, Chris Schneier developed it. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. That was his company, in fact. And after that, I've seen PPG. I've seen other things like this. Do you have any idea why in the present society people are so open with these communications and they send stuff basically through the internet and through the air and through everywhere without encrypting it? Or do you feel that encryption is something that just can be hacked and broken into and it's meaningless to use?
Well, I mean, when I was a fugitive, the FBI used encrypted radio transmissions. And I really wanted to know what they were saying in case they were close to me to ensure that they're not talking about me so that I can get the hell out of there. And so rather than trying to crack the crypto, which was developed by Motorola, or try to get the key, which would have been impossible, how the attack I did was what we call a denial of service attack, is when one side of the FBI was communicating with the other, I would jam the signal. And I did this like for 3 or 4 times, and then the agents thought their radios were malfunctioning, and they went into the clear so I could hear the whole conversation. So that was a way of like cracking government crypto without having to break the key.
Yeah, right. But I wasn't talking about government. I was talking about me sending you an email so that I know only you would be getting it. In fact, I am so terrified of this email business that most of my communications with the outside world, I seriously use U.S. mail for almost everything.
But if I wanted to get your communications, I wouldn't be worried about intercepting it in real time.
Yeah.
I'd basically break into your system using some sort of exploit and plant malware, so I could just intercept your keystrokes.
Yeah, because I've had problems.
So just because you use encrypted email doesn't mean you're secure.
So you're saying the encrypted email is really hackable, even if it isn't.
That depends on the endpoints. You have a sender. You have Alice and Bob. Yeah. If you could break into Alice or Bob's computer, you can get the unencrypted communication without bothering by cracking the key.
Because I've been a victim of two banks. This is why I got this, to be so fearful of this, where a municipal bond was being transferred from one bank to the other as paying agent, and between the two banks, it was literally robbed into neverwhere. It took them 3 years to try to trace it because I had a sales receipt for the bond. That was the only thing that was physical on paper. From that point on, I do robotics, I do programming, I'm very much into public domain, but I am terrified of email, and I think you understand the reason.
I can understand.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you for coming. I want to pass the mic to somebody, the gentleman here, over here, and then we'll...
How did you get started with the Free Kevin movement?
Well, I actually didn't get started with it. It was 2600 Magazine, and what had happened is, because of the unusual things that happened in my case, that I was held for 4.5 years without a trial, And there was a lot of, they wouldn't give us access to the discovery. There was a lot of issues in the case. And then Emmanuel Goldstein, after about 3 years of this happening, started the Free Kevin movement to get the word out about what was happening with my case.
How did you hear about it originally?
Basically by by family, by people sending me snail mail when I was in custody. That's how I found it. You know, through telephone calls that I had with family and friends.
Yeah, no, I just thought it was an interesting story of you putting the sticker up to the window and everything in prison.
Oh, yeah, when I was in custody, they actually sent me some Free Kevin bumper stickers. And on my 35th birthday, some people from 2600 Magazine came out to the prison, and I knew they were down there, and then I said, well, wait till 1:30. I can get a pass to the law library, and I had a Free Kevin bumper sticker. And while I was in custody in federal detention, I was able to put the Free Kevin bumper sticker up, and they were able to snap a photo. So it's on the box set of Freedom Downtime.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. I think you're next. Okay, you go ahead, since the mic's next to you.
Does being a white hat
I can't hear you.
Oh. Does being a white hat give you enough thrill and interest?
Microphone.
Oh, does being a white hat hacker give you enough thrill and interest to replace what used to be black
hat? Oh, yeah. I mean, my drivers for hacking were intellectual curiosity, pursuit of knowledge, seduction of adventure. It was never about stealing money or writing malware. And so I did get a huge endorphin rush when I was able to crack a system, because it was like a video game of bypassing security obstacles. So I get the same endorphins today. Like when I get into a client system, I really feel good about it, and it's kind of still like a little bit of thrill seeking. So I get paid for what I did illegally years ago, which is pretty good. You know, it's like, you know, where can you take something that's a criminal activity and make it legal? Yeah.
So when I saw you doing the HID intercept,
yeah,
my immediate thought was NFC cell phone payments, where they want to basically have, you know, like a, just for everybody who knows, you know, it's like a RFID kind of tech. So is that pretty easily breakable as well?
I haven't really messed with RFID. There's a guy named Chris Padgett. Mm-hmm. If you Google his name, he was able to, I think at DEF CON, which is a hacker security conference in Las Vegas, was able to intercept RFID cards at a pretty substantial distance. And I haven't researched, the HID technology is the only technology that I have looked at because of doing physical pen testing. Mm-hmm. I haven't really looked into RFID stuff. Okay. Yeah.
Hi.
Hey.
So, obviously, you've experienced the problems of the system. And
just a bit.
Yeah, and what type of advocacy do you do today in order to fix some of these things? I know you've testified before Congress and stuff like that, but is there any more underground stuff going on?
Well, really, I haven't advocated anything because I feel like I'm powerless to change the system. So I the world has changed. You know, my case was prior to 9/11. And everything has completely changed. Now we have the Patriot Act, and we have a lot of laws that are passed to protect us from terrorism, but then the government still wants to, you know, keep those laws on the books, you know, even after, you know, threats dissolve, because it gives them more power. So, I mean, it's actually gotten worse than it was back in the mid-90s. And unfortunately, we have to live with it, you know. So, yeah. Yes.
The Lopez. Question for you. My intrigue has started at a young age with computers, much inspired by you, I must say. Thank you. What was your first experience with a computer system that caught your intrigue?
High school. I was a senior in high school, and I tried to actually get into the computer class, and the instructor refused because I didn't meet the prerequisites of having calculus and all these other prerequisites under my belt. So I started showing him some of the tricks I can do with the phone company. He said, okay, you can come into class, right? So that was like my first experience kind of working with computers. Of course, the teacher probably regrets that decision today because I kind of drove him crazy. One of the first programming assignments in Fortran was to write a program that would find the first 100 Fibonacci numbers. And I thought that was kind of boring. I thought a cooler program would be a program that would steal everybody's password. Because that's kind of cool. So the students would be at their terminals, they would log in, but I actually wrote what we call a login simulator. So when they're logging in, they're actually talking to my program, not to the computer's operating system. So unfortunately, I didn't have enough time to finish the Fibonacci assignment, but then I turned in my password stealer program, and the teacher was actually impressed and gave me an A. And a lot of attaboys, and said, hey, Kevin wrote this cool program and showed it to the class. Today, if you did it in school, you'd probably be arrested. You know, so back in my day, hacking was not illegal, and you were actually encouraged by teachers in high school that it was a cool thing to do. Right, and because probably of these ethics is kind of what led me on the path where I started out, you know, hacking, and I got so passionate with it that I just didn't stop. Any other questions? You got a question over there.
Sorry, I got it right here.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, when you were doing all of your hacking and when you were on the lam, did you think that you were going to get caught? And, you know, was it worth it when at the end?
Well, no. Actually, when I was running from the government, I was so adept at creating new identities and that I thought it would be really difficult. I always thought in the back of my mind, I keep doing the same thing. Because I continued the hacking, of course. So eventually I figured, well, if I made a mistake, I probably could get caught. But I wasn't thinking when I was on the run that I'm going to get caught. I actually thought I was going to outsmart the FBI, which obviously was a ridiculous notion. But then it was, you know, many, many years ago. And what this, you know, became is a cat and mouse game between me and the government. And I looked at it as a video game. When I was running, I didn't look over my shoulder. I wasn't afraid, like every cop car that passed. I wasn't worried because I had bona fide government-issued ID, and I had legitimate jobs. I was working at a law firm in Denver. I was working at a hospital in Seattle. And I set up early warning systems at the law firm. One of my responsibilities was supporting the law firm's telephone system, which was kind of cool. I couldn't have written this job description better myself because now I was able to insert code into the phone system. So if anybody in the law firm called the U.S. Attorney's Office or the FBI, it would immediately send me a page with a four-digit code that was 6565, which happened to be the last four digits of the telephone number for the FBI in Los Angeles. So I set up these early warning systems so if anyone hit the tripwire, I would be able to get out quickly enough.
Hey, I want to know, I mean, it seems like obviously you were animated to do all this for the thrill of it.
Generally. Right.
Is there anything out there that you're seeing now that actually, you know, kind of scares you that people are doing things that are destructive,
changed.
That are...
Yeah, the trend for hacking has changed. Now it's all about, you know, organized crime, leveraging hacking skills or recruiting hackers to steal credit card accounts, identity theft, bank fraud. Now it's become a real huge problem because back in my day, the people I associated with and myself, again, it wasn't about the money. It was about the thrill and exploration. And it's all changed. I mean, you still have groups of hackers that probably do it, maybe LulzSec, but I think LulzSec was more for the media attention than for trying to send a political message. But most of the trend has gone towards profit that I've seen. There's my walk.
So I have kind of a funny question. I've heard a couple of different versions of the day you got actually arrested?
Yes.
So one of the versions has you coming to the door and the FBI agent saying, oh, this is Kevin, or you're Kevin, and you kind of denied it and said, oh, well, do you want me to show up tomorrow? And it kind of threw him for a loop. And the other one, that's
totally
missing.
Well, it's a longer story. It's actually detailed in the book.
Oh, excellent.
But the full details of what had happened is I actually had the FBI, they weren't sure that I was Kevin Mitnick for about 3.5 hours. Because I guess I was a good actor that day. And I remember at one point when they were searching my apartment, they actually handed me a wanted poster, wanted for supervised release. They handed it to me and they said, doesn't that look like you? And I studied it for a moment, thinking maybe I could really get out of this. And I go, no, it doesn't. I mean, what am I going to say, right? So I had them going for like 3.5 hours because they don't play games. If they knew I was Mitnick, they'd arrest me and take me down. They don't have time to, you know, joke around. So I was really hoping, and at one point, I was really hoping I could, you know, get out of that situation. One of the the case agent says, well, we're going to have to take you down to the FBI office and fingerprint you to try to see if you're really Mitnick or not. I said, why didn't you think of that idea earlier? And then we wouldn't have wasted all this time. In fact, tell me what time to show up tomorrow morning, and I'll be at your office. I tried. I had nothing to lose, right? So I did my best. Of course, it didn't work, but I did my best.
Does this work?
Use the mic.
My question was actually about, I think in essence your book is a lot about social, you're hacking as social engineering. And
it's both, actually.
And do you consider yourself more analogous to Frank Abagnale Jr. than you do, like, our stereotypical, like, understanding of what a hacker is? Like, from what we see in movies, like in Hackers or Sneakers, do you think that's more of what you do as opposed to, like, what Frank Abagnale Jr. was doing?
Well, actually, I was doing, like, when I was doing attacks, it would be a hybrid of social engineering and technical attacks. And then, for example, let's say I use a technical exploit to get into a large company, and I was looking for a piece of code because I wanted to examine that code, because if I got access to that code, I could figure out how to break into that type of operating system. And then I would use social engineering once I got in to find out what server the code I was interested in was on, because it would be much faster than me sitting on the network for a month looking for it. So I basically use social engineering, and I'd use technical exploitation. But in the book, we focused more on the social engineering side because we thought that was more interesting. Right? And Frank Abagnale actually reviewed the book, and he liked it. He actually called me a master social engineer. I don't know what that means in his category, but I guess it's a compliment. So I was very happy that he did, because he never reviews books, so it was a great honor, actually, to have my book reviewed by him. Any other questions?
What's your relationship to
John Markoff?
John Markoff. There's some Twitter.
Oh, you follow me on Twitter.
Static.
Okay. Yeah, well, obviously, John Markoff and I haven't spoken. John Markoff is a New York Times reporter who wrote about me back in the 1990s. And in his reporting, he actually had stated things as fact that weren't true, that I hacked into NORAD in 1983 and nearly started a nuclear war. Well, that was right out of War Games. Amongst other ridiculous accusations as fact, and what it did was it elevated the interest that the government had in the Kevin Mitnick case. And his agenda, I think was his agenda, was actually he wanted to write a book and do a movie. And so if you have the New York Times at your disposal, imagine the interest you can create and make, you know, you can cash in. So on Twitter the other day, of course, you know, I'm a naturally born smart ass. So I tweeted, I said, the New York Times did a book review. And I tweeted, I don't understand this. The New York Times did a book review, but the last three times they wrote about me, I was on the front page, and I'm not on the front page this time. So Markoff, who this wasn't directed towards, actually responded one or two days later and says, well, maybe that's because it wasn't written well. Now, kind of like a dig. And so I told him, I said, listen, I said, John, let bygones be bygones. I really think you should become a fictional writer because you have a great imagination. So then it all stopped. Anybody else?
Were you on the carding game also?
On the what?
The carding game, the carders. Were you
no,
also a card?
I never carded that. Carding is using other people's credit card numbers.
Have you read Kevin Paulson's new book?
Yes, it's an excellent new book. It's called Kingpin. It's about the carding underground, and I highly recommended it. I really enjoyed his book.
Okay, so it's just everything is true in that book. Everything is true in that book.
I believe so. Yeah.
Is there anything you'd like to share that we don't see in the book that got cut from an earlier
version? Oh, we could be here all night.
Well, send in the,
you know, bring the mojitos.
Particular interest.
Party for till tomorrow morning. I mean, yeah, there was a lot I couldn't put in the book. In fact, my editor, John Parsley over there, my fantastic editor, kept telling Bill and I, you know, word count, you're over word count, you're over word count. You have to cut 10, 20, 30%. And I couldn't figure out what stories to cut because they were all so interesting to me. And it was just like a miracle. I guess John decided, hey, we're going to leave a lot of these stories in, and we didn't actually have to cut it out. But I actually had more to tell. I was talking to Bill the other night. I go, we just missed the story, you know, I wanted to include. You know, we both laugh about it because obviously you can't edit in now. But there's lots of other stories that I could... The next book. I'm trying to think of one I was thinking of the other day. Okay, here's one. Is when I was running from the government, on my computer I kept everything encrypted. And at the time I was using Norton's Discrete. And Discrete was supposed to be using 56-bit DES to encrypt your virtual disk. And this guy named Peter Gutman, who is a world-renowned cryptographer, wrote a white paper talking about how vulnerable Discrete was. And when I read it, I go, oh my God, you know, I'm using this product. So what I did is, you know, as a hacker would, I actually hacked into Norton and took the source code to Discrete and analyzed it myself and found out there was only 30 bits of entropy, meaning that their 56 bits key was really 30 effective bits, which means that anybody can crack it in no time. So, of course, as any good hacker would, I changed the encryption tool I was using, and the feds never were able to crack the key. So there's one story that's not in the book. Hand back there.
Do you have any advice for starting your own penetration testing company or anything like that? I mean, obviously things are a lot different nowadays.
You want to be prosecuted. My competitor, and I'm going to advise you. No, I think it's a terrible business, and you shouldn't compete. Actually, hire the best people. When I do pen tests, you know, I have an hourly rate, and what I do is I figure out how many hours it's going to take to do the pen test, and because I'm so passionate with this type of technology, I ordinarily spend twice the amount of time. So I'm basically, you know, doing this as pretty much free, because in the scope of the agreement, I only have to spend X amount of time. But then I find I want to investigate something. I think this would actually work. And then I end up spending sometimes double the time on the engagement, and I'm not charging the client more because I want to do a great job for the client. So the good thing is I get a lot of repeat business, because my clients go, wow, you went really overboard. Yeah, because I wanted to own everything you have. Because unless I could own means break in. Because, you know, if I didn't break into everything, I don't feel I did my job. So.
All right, I don't know really where to start with this. When you were talking today, you're saying the world has changed a lot. I know from my experiences, I do work with high school students and I do teach. And there are a lot of kids out there that are fascinated by hacking. But what they're doing are things like trying to take the video games and get the code so they can change the game slightly, so they can move one game platform to a computer or something else. And old-style hacking is alive and well to some extent. The second thing I wanted to point out, how do you feel about open-source material, open-source coding, Linux, things that are publicly shared?
Yeah, I'm a proponent of open source. I use it myself. And in fact, there was a 10-year-old girl at DEF CON this year. They had Kids Con, and she was actually able to crack some of the video games on messing with the timing. So here you had a 10-year-old girl that was a hacker, you know, to play games. So it's like kids these days, you know, what are they going to grow up to be? Really good pen testers or scary people, right? So... any other questions? So, you know, these business cards actually cost me money. So rather than sell them to you, all I need is your password. I'm kidding. Or your social. It's been great talking to everybody here, and one last thing is, in each chapter, you'll see on the chapter heading, there's a cryptogram. So on the odd chapters, the cryptograms are quite easy. On the even chapters, they're a little bit more difficult. And because I can't legally do this, but this is what I will probably do, it's not a promise, is I'm going to find everybody who was able to crack the codes. I'm going to probably have a website they could register at and prove they were able to do it. I'm going to probably put their names in a bucket and draw out 10 names. And the FBI was kind enough to return all my computer evidence, which is still in the FBI evidence bags with fingerprint dust. So I'm probably going to give out like 10 of those as kind of a gift. But it's not a promise, so it's not a contest. But that's probably what I'll do. All right. So I'll be happy to give out cards, sign books, or whatever. All right. Get all this technology.
Can I get a picture with you, man?
Yeah, let me do that after.